Welcome to this edition of CBN News Weekend. I'm Charlene Aaron. A controversial gender identity policy played a role in driving concerned parents to the polls in Fairfax County, Virginia. Judicial Watch has told CBN News there is evidence that the policy was implemented before it was voted on.
Earlier this year, school board members in Fairfax County voted to add gender identity to its non-discrimination policy, despite overwhelming opposition from parents. Many in the district argue the policy would allow male students and teachers who identify as transgender to use the girls' locker rooms and bathrooms and vice versa.
They're cramming an agenda, their own agenda, down parents' throats. We have no voice. We have a voice and they don't want to listen to us. They've ignored us.
It has no place in the school system. We have 17 failing schools throughout this county, and this is what they're concerned with. I have girls, and I am deeply concerned with the fact that they want to share bathrooms with transgender kids. That puts my children at risk, and I'm not going to allow that.
Judicial Watch, a conservative nonpartisan watch group, learned that the school district actually began implementing policy changes to accommodate transgender students even before hastily voting on the issue.
Oh, it's clear, even in the records we've gotten so far, that they were off and running, that this was an objective of theirs, that they were acting on and attempting to line up before any vote was ever taken. They were going to push this through no matter what.
In April, Judicial Watch requested the school board provide documents about the controversial gender identity policy under the Freedom of Information Act because critics had questions, arguing that the school board has more pressing needs.
Despite the school board running a $100 million plus, in the red. And so we were curious as to what the motivation was. Why is this such a big issue? Why does it need to be addressed now? How does it trump all the other issues that are before the county? And so we asked questions. We sought documents and records under the law.
But the school board filed a lawsuit to block the release of documents until after this week's school board election. Fairfax County is the largest school district in the state and the 10th largest in the country. Many say what happens here could have a powerful effect in school districts across the country.
Organizers of the annual March for Life are working to recruit new soldiers in the fight against abortion. Next year, they hope to take advantage of the presidential election likely to pit a female pro-choice champion against a pro-lifer. As Paul Strand reports from Capitol Hill, they want the country to know that pro-life and pro-woman go hand in hand.
Most political observers agree Hillary Clinton will be the Democrats' likely presidential nominee. If so, the public can expect speeches and ads about how pro-life Republicans wage a war on women when they try to limit abortions. In an attempt to take on that rhetoric, those at this Capitol Hill gathering announced the theme of 2016's March for Life is pro-life and pro-woman go hand in hand.
Somehow in recent years, being pro-life has become equated with waging a war on women. This event is all about proving that's not the case.
We keep hearing in the media and throughout the different debates, especially with the upcoming election, that in order for someone to be pro-woman, they have to be pro-abortion or pro-choice. We say that the opposite is the case, that no woman in her right mind should ever be put into a corner like that to want to make a choice like abortion.
These leaders are outraged that abortion supporters were able to hijack the feminist cause.
For some crazy reason, supporters of legal abortion were able to make their cause synonymous with women. And it's just the height of irony when you think that what they did essentially was treat women as victims, do nothing to empower them. They've never set up a crisis pregnancy center. They've never set up a post-abortion healing. And basically affirm a male model of human sexuality. Sex, no baby.
I find it sad. Peace begins in the womb. And we believe in peaceful coexistence between mothers and children. So, you know, women deserve better than abortion, and every child deserves their right to life.
A woman's capacity for motherhood is a tremendous gift, and we want to celebrate that. We know that being pro-woman really actually means being pro-life. Pro-life is pro-woman. It's pro-child, and it's pro-woman.
The 41st March for Life will be January 22nd, marking the day in 1974 when the Supreme Court legalized abortion. Paul Strand, CBN News, Capitol Hill.
Well, this may be one for the record books. An order of nuns in Wisconsin has continually prayed for people for the last 137 years. Members of the Franciscan Sisters of Perpetual Adoration have been working in shifts since 1878. The La Crosse, Wisconsin nuns take turns lifting up prayers for the sick, troubled, and stressed out, and they do it nonstop, day and night. The 100 sisters do get some help from about 180 prayer partners, but the nuns usually take the longer night shifts. Well, have you noticed that prayer has been in the news a lot lately? A Washington State high school football coach was placed on administrative leave for personally praying on the field after football games. Compare that to the new House Speaker Paul Ryan's public request to his colleagues to pray for each other. Sometimes it seems like it's a tale of two Washingtons. CBN's John Jessup and Jennifer Wishon are jumping into the sometimes controversial topic of public prayer in the latest Beltway Buzz.
Welcome to this edition of Beltway Buzz. I'm Jennifer Wishon.
And I'm John Jessup. You know, Jennifer, something that we do every day, at least most Americans do, according to Pew, is pray. It just seems as though Americans are less comfortable talking about it, at least publicly.
Absolutely, John. You know, if you look at what happened in the news this week, it's there's really this huge juxtaposition of prayer, really a tale of two Washingtons. If you look at what happened in Washington State, we have a high school football coach, Joe Kennedy, who is currently on paid administrative leave because after football games, he walks to the middle of the field, kneels down, and prays. It's something he's been doing for years without incident, but just this week, he was put on paid administrative leave. So you compare that to what is happening here in Washington, D.C., inside the Beltway. Some of our most senior elected officials have been asking for prayer.
Right.
Let's take a listen.
So if you ever pray, let's pray for each other. Republicans for Democrats, and Democrats for Republicans.
Wow. You know, Jennifer, it's so intriguing to hear so many highly visible, high-profile public officials talk about prayer, from the newly minted Speaker Ryan to someone I recently interviewed, Bishop T.D. Jakes, to even the Pope when he was here in the United States. All these people asking others to pray for them. I know people around the country are constantly praying for our leaders. They're praying for President Obama, who often talks about his Christian faith. I'm curious, has the White House at all weighed in?
Well, I asked the White House specifically, you know, does the president agree with the way the Bremerton School District is handling Coach Joe Kennedy? And also generally, you know, does the president think it's a violation of the Establishment Clause of the First Amendment for coaches and teachers and other role models at schools to pray during school or during school events? And on both cases, the White House declined to comment, which I really think is a missed opportunity.
Wow. Well, you know, Speaker Ryan talked about prayer, and so did former Speaker John Boehner. I'm curious what your thoughts are about his discussion of prayer recently.
Yeah, well, as you know, Speaker Boehner wears his heart on his sleeve, and it was really interesting this week to see him release this high-profile video, not only talking about prayer, but about the Holy Spirit. Let's watch.
I'm sitting around with this. You probably didn't see this news show on Sunday, but I did this news show, and the question was about the power of the Holy Spirit. And this question has been bothering me ever since. And Colonel World says, well, John, you know, we don't normally recognize the power of the Holy Spirit except in retrospect. And then instantly, all the dots lined up.
Well, you know, John, so often we talk about prayer and we tell people we're gonna pray for them, and sometimes it's not sincere, but to hear the Speaker of the House, the outgoing Speaker, talk about how the Holy Spirit is moving in his life, it's really extraordinary.
That's phenomenal. You know, Jennifer, recently former Senator John Danforth came in and talked to us about how the Founding Fathers constructed the Constitution in a way that serves as the glue to hold us all together, despite the fact that we may be very different, whether it's politically or even religiously. Let's take a listen.
People who had really strong beliefs on slavery, the most divisive issue that we've ever had in our country, and yet, despite their strong disagreements, they created a system which permitted us to hold ourselves together. And I think that that's a religious message also, to hold ourselves together. Jesus prayed that we all may be one. That's got some meaning, doesn't it? That we're one.
That's a really great reminder. And you know, what I love about what he's saying is that so often the Constitution is used to divide us. Mm. But he's reminding us that it really is what unifies us, no matter who we are.
That's right. And speaking of the Constitution, you know, these debates have been going on since the founding of our nation, and I'm sure that we'll be continuing the debate for years to come. For more insight on this topic and others inside the Beltway and beyond, we invite you to go to our website, cbnnews.com, and check out our blog, Beltway Buzz.
Up next, your favorite technology could be messing with your mind. We'll explain what's behind a new phenomenon called digital amnesia. Well, we can probably all agree that technology makes life a lot easier. But do you ever wonder if our dependence on it could actually be messing with our minds? CBN's Caleb Kinchlow and Ephraim Graham did some digging about that, and researchers now say it is. It's giving us something called digital amnesia. Take a look.
An epidemic is sweeping the globe.
If my phone is dead, I'm dead.
Riding in our desire for convenience, efficiency, and instant gratification.
Starting route to the Twilight Zone.
You may have it and not even know it.
I can't get anywhere without my GPS.
Digital amnesia. Welcome to the Twilight Zone.
I think you mean digital download.
Okay, that too.
And as Ephraim just said, today we're talking about digital amnesia. And if you use any kind of device, chances are you're infected. And it's not just a problem for young people. New numbers show people of all ages are outsourcing work intended for our brains to technology.
Watch what happened. We asked random people how many phone numbers they actually knew from memory.
I know my cell phone and maybe like my dad's and my close relatives, that's about it.
Two.
We also found the search for information has been reduced to one word.
Google it.
Sure, technology makes our lives easier, which isn't always a bad thing. But experts say we should consider unplugging and thinking from time to time.
What this is doing to our brains is it's keeping us from forming those muscle memories. It's why a lot of kids today are struggling in school because they can't even answer conceptual questions because they spend so much time, you know, on some sort of device, just plugging everything in.
We're also finding out that people are losing that face-to-face contact and not reading the cues, the nonverbal cues of the face and the body that are so critical for what we would call emotional intelligence, where you're trying to read other people, understand what's going on in the moment.
Have no fear. If you think you have digital amnesia, there are ways you can get better.
Of course, and ironically, we found a couple of apps to help you cut back on your tech time. One is called Moment. It tracks how much you use your phone each day and sets limits for you. You can even force yourself off the app if you go over your limit. A similar app is called Break Free. It gives you what is called an addiction score and helps you learn how bad the problem is and gives you tools to, well, break free.
Or you know what, there's always just putting the device away and enjoying life.
Yeah, I guess that works too. Well, I'm Caleb Kinchlow.
And I'm Ephraim Graham, and this is your digital download.
Coming up, he's topping gospel charts with a song to comfort the hurting and remind all listeners who gives us worth. He is the Baltimore native behind a song that's still topping the gospel charts months after its release. Anthony Brown in Group Therapy's song Worth praises God for saving lives and giving worth to his children. Brown joined CBN's Ephraim Graham this week in Studio 5.
Anthony Brown and Group Therapy are the voices behind this chart-topping tune. It's simply called Worth.
Now, your music, the song Worth, has been number one
It has
for
now,
a few weeks,
for a couple weeks, which is surprising to me. I was shocked. It's actually my first number one.
Really?
Yeah. Testimony was great. It never got to number one. It probably got to number three, I think. So when my radio rep called me and said it was number one, I was like, "You gotta be kidding!" And it has been there for a couple weeks.
Nice. Tell us about the song. What's the story behind it?
Man, you know, the song is so simple. You know, and I think when I wrote it, I never thought, because it's such a simple song, that it would go and translate so far. But I wrote it in communion service at my church. I was literally sitting in communion at First Baptist Church of Glen Arden, which is my church. Pastor Jenkins was talking, and we were doing communion. And I started thinking about the whole concept that Jesus, the Son of God, died for my sins. That he thought I was worth that. And I took out my iPad and started writing, you know, typing, "You thought I was worth saving." And literally four lines came out and that was it. So I sung it at my church probably a month later just to test it out. And the response was so overwhelming that I knew I gotta record this, you know? And I just thought it was so simple and so minuscule, but obviously it's resonated with a lot of people.
Love the song as
Thank
well.
You.
What
Thanks.
What have people been saying to you about it?
I get a lot of emails that really touch my heart. I'm talking about this very reluctantly because it does create emotion in me, but to know that there are people out there who struggle with their identity, they struggle with knowing that they're worth anything. And I think society makes people feel like they can never live up to a certain standard or become whatever that standard is. And to hear that the song, those words, are resonating with people in a way where they're like, "No, I know that I'm worth something. I know that God created me for a purpose." It means so much to me. I wrote it, you know, like I said, in my church, and to know that it's gone so far away out of this country and just across the world, for me, just, it blows my mind.
This may be his first number one single, but the Baltimore native and classically trained pianist isn't new to music.
I grew up a pastor's kid, so I grew up in church all of my life. Started playing when I was 3 years old, and took my first minister of music job when I was 12, teaching a bunch of adults.
So you say at 12?
At 12 years old, I'm up there, you know, on the piano teaching a bunch of adults. And I'm like, who is this kid? But it's always been my passion, always been my desire to use the gift that God gave me. I saw myself doing Disney. That's what I wanted to be. So I'm like, you know, "Lord, I'm gonna take you, me, we're going over to Disney, we're gonna do The Lion King." That's what I wanted to do. You know, and I saw those characters and the songs. That's my style, I love it. And so it wasn't this. I definitely saw myself more Broadway and Disney, but you know, God had a plan.
How did the path begin this way? So you were, you're thinking Broadway and so forth. How does the path push you here?
Well, I'm a servant by nature. And so there are different artists who I love, namely this lady named Marette Brown Clark, who mm-hmm. is, she's like my mom. She's my heart. And she was doing a project, and I said, "Mom," you know, so I called her. I wrote a song that I think I want you to hear. And we were driving to a concert. She was going to be in concert with Richard Smallwood, and I really wanted to go because I'm a huge, humongous Richard Smallwood fan. And I said, "I have a song I want you to hear." She said, "Okay." And, so I'm driving with her, no track, no music, and I just say, "I know the odds look stacked against you, and it seems there's no way out." And I'm singing the song, "It Ain't Over," and she just starts crying.
So just know, it ain't over.
The song rose to number one for Marette Brown Clark, and Anthony would go on to write hits for gospel greats like Donnie McClurkin, Donald Lawrence, Stephen Hurd, and Vashawn Mitchell, who actually encouraged Brown to record his first project, Testimony.
I sent Vashawn Testimony when I finished recording it. And I said, "I'm gonna release it at my church. I just want you to hear it. Tell me what you think." He called me immediately and he said, "You cannot release that song at your church." I said, "Why not?"
So, it's home.
Right, exactly. He's like, "No, that song needs to be heard by way more people than you have access to." I'm like, "Vashawn, I've tried this, that, and the third." He said, "What if I can find a situation for you that you really like?" I said, "Okay, you know." And that night he called me with who is now my label president, on the phone. And 2 weeks later, I signed a deal.
And that was the public birth of the group the world now knows as Anthony Brown and Group Therapy.
Now, the group behind your voice,
yeah,
Group Therapy, the AP stands for something. Tell me about how this group started and...
Yeah. The AP is always capitalized in therapy, and it's because the group used to be called Answered Prayers. They've been with me for 15 years. We met in college, and it wasn't like, Lord, send me a group, you know what I mean? It was like I was in a practice room one day playing some songs. I'm like, hey, you, come here, sing this song. And that's literally what happened. 15 years later, we're still doing it. You, come here and sing this song. We never signed any contracts. They are literally my family. And when I moved to California, they moved to California. Nobody knows this, so I'm telling you something super exclusive. I moved to California. They all quit their jobs, and they moved to California with me and moved into my one-bedroom apartment. So we have one bedroom. All the guys are in the living room. All the girls are in the bedroom. And that's where the unit, the tightness, the closeness of group therapy comes from, because we literally have been to the backside of the mountain and back together.
So what can we expect next? What's going to happen?
Wow, you know, you never know. I have big dreams, and doing music is one of those things, but I would love to take music to another place. In my mind, I want to fuse something that looks like Cirque du Soleil goes gospel. I see it being on a stage. I see it being theatrical and performance-driven, but taking the gospel to that arena, I think, opens us up to so many more people who may never step foot in the church. And so, if I have my way next year, I'll be doing something like that.
Certainly be watching for it. Worth is still at the top of the charts. Stay with us. We'll be right back. And finally, Superbook is airing on Bulgarian national television for the last year. Recently, two Superbook events were held in the northern part of Bulgaria, where more than 200 children attended the event and watched Superbook episodes with their parents. Afterwards, many children accepted Jesus Christ as their Savior, and they were invited along with their parents to a local Sunday school service. Praise God for that. And that is going to do it for this hour of CBN News Weekend. You can find more of our exclusive coverage of the issues you care most about at cbnnews.com, and stay up to date with CBN News through Facebook and Twitter. We hope you'll join us next time. Have a wonderful weekend, and may God bless you richly.